Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this latest part of the Arise Festival. So my name is Rachel Garnham. I am Vice Chair of the Campaign for Labour Party Democracy, convener of Eastern Labour Left and a former Labour Party NEC member. And I'm really pleased to welcome you to this important event and discussion tonight on real change in Ireland, lessons for the left, as part of Arise 2022, an online festival of Labour's left ideas. So here in Britain, we need to obviously build resistance to the Tories. What a terrible shower they are in the latest leadership election. But we also need to popularise support for socialist solutions to the various crises we face. And to do that, we need to learn the lessons of other struggles and offer our solidarity to all those struggling for a better world and social justice across the globe. And that is especially the case when it comes to Ireland, right on our doorstep. So the discussion we're having tonight is an essential one. Sinn Fein's victory in the recent assembly elections in the north of Ireland and continuing advances in the south show that real change is on the agenda in Ireland and has raised the prospect of a united Ireland. And I've been attending these sessions for several years, and it's never been a more topical issue, and it's one of the few causes of optimism, I think, for us on the left in Britain in these difficult political times. So for many of us active in solidarity with the Irish cause over the years and the decades, the elections are further confirmation of our need to step up this work. We need to be building links with the left and progressive movements in Ireland, and make the case here for a border poll. And that includes making the case for a border poll in the Labour Party and the broader Labour movement. And I hope we'll get round to discussing how we can do that this evening. So tonight we'll be looking at what we can learn and how we can support peace, self-determination and social progress. And I just want to say, I think Arise has done a brilliant job of making sure that Ireland is on the agenda and raising the level of political education of the left. And so I want to thank Arise for doing that once again. And please do donate if you can. We'll be coming back to how you can do that, but make sure you buy a ticket for the whole of the festival using the links that will be in the chat throughout this evening. So due to a really fantastic level of interest, as well as this Zoom webinar, we're streaming live direct from the Arise YouTube page and over a dozen Facebook pages. As you'll be familiar with, the format is we'll hear from the speakers and take some questions. So as the event goes on, please do make sure you post your questions in the Q&A section on Zoom, and we'll put some to our panel. So you don't want to hear from me, we need to move to our panel. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome and introduce our first speaker. Very pleased to have Emma Sheerin, MLA, who's a Sinn Féin member for Mid-Ulster, and I'll hand over to you, Emma, and welcome and thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much, Rachel, for that kind introduction. I'm joining you here from a somewhat sunny South Derry, and I'm delighted to be on the call, and I suppose always a pleasure to talk about left politics and about Irish unity, two of my favourite subjects, but given the current climate and the context in which we're talking, it's particularly good to be having this discussion, and I want to congratulate the organisers of Arise Festival and everybody involved in Labour for Irish Unity, and thank you for asking me to take part in, and I'm really excited about this conversation. So I suppose I've been asked to talk about the topic for this evening, Lessons for the Left, and given the historic result that we had on the 5th of May in the north, sort of the campaign that we ran and what can be taken from that and how to progress left politics in Ireland, in Britain and elsewhere. And I'm delighted to share the small amount of information I have about that. Obviously, our election in May was the 5th of May, and anybody who's a Republican or who has any knowledge of Irish history and politics will understand the poignance of that date for Republicans, given that the 5th of May 1981 is the date on which Bobby Sands, who was elected MP for Fermanagh and South Tyrone at the time, died on hunger strike, the first of 10 hunger strikers to die in 1981. So it was all the more for us, I suppose, significant that we were having such an important election on that date, and an election that has proved to be the game changer that at the time we knew it had the potential to be. And I suppose to fully set the scene there and to give a bit of context, you've referred, Rachel, in your opening remarks to the fact that Sinn Féin is in a good place north and south at the minute, and we have had a number of elections in recent years that have shown significant progress for ourselves as a party. And I'm talking about us as a political party, but anybody who's aware of Sinn Féin and is familiar with us will know that we're more than a political party. We're a rooted Republican grassroots movement, and that's what we pride ourselves on, and that's everyone that takes part in elected politics for Sinn Féin begins as an activist, and that's something that I'm very proud of, and I wouldn't be there if that wasn't the case. So I suppose the turning point in recent years was probably the 2017 elections, which followed us collapsing the Assembly because of financial scandal, basically initiated by the DUP or controlled by the DUP, a refusal from Arlene Foster, who was at the time the DUP First Minister, to step aside to allow a public inquiry, which then led to the Assembly collapse. And that was in the wake of numerous agreements that had been made, particularly around rights issues, that the DUP had signed up to and then refused to implement. And we've seen sort of a situation that escalated to the point where it could no longer continue. And in 2017, we had two very successful elections, took almost 28% of the first preference vote in the Assembly election of March that year, and followed it up then with a record Westminster election result for ourselves, returning 7 MPs that year and winning Westminster seats that we had never touched before, one of which we have since retained. Then closely following that, February 22, just prior to the COVID-19 pandemic, we had our best result in the 26 counties in recent years, with sort of a landslide victory for Sinn Féin. We took the highest percentage of the popular vote and returned 37 TDs. And the whole basis of that election campaign was change. It was left politics. It was an answer and an opposition to almost at that stage 100 years of Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael governments in the 26 counties that have allowed us to see a housing crisis, that have allowed people to live in abject poverty, a cost of living crisis, and to allow those at the top to flourish. And we've seen that for decades in the 26 counties, and 2020 was sort of a turning point. Obviously, Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil since coalesced in order to keep us out of government, but there is really room there for growth. And obviously, we had a motion just yesterday of no confidence in the government following scandal after scandal there, and we will see how this plays out in the next couple of months. But you can see the cronyism and the keeping each other comfortable being shook and being rattled by the result in the 2020 election of February of that year. Then 2020 brought us COVID, and I suppose the past 2 years have shown how, as an antidote to DUP refusal to deliver on rights, of corruption at the heart of government, at just negativity and refusal to acknowledge the need for people to be able to have a living wage and live a prosperous life and be able to go to work and do all the things that they need to do. And we had, through a sort of concerted effort from ourselves, working with other progressive parties in the Assembly, we were able to deliver on an awful lot. So obviously COVID-19 played a massive part in the 2-year mandate and our reaction to that. And working alongside the DUP as joint First Ministers, we were able to react quickly and bring in force measures that weren't perfect, but allowed us to minimise the risk to public health. And then following on from that, the latter part of the mandate, we delivered legislation which has actually got the potential to actually change lives, and things like an autism bill, free period products for young people in public places, we've seen a scrapping of hospital charging, car park charging fees. Number of things with parties working together to deliver change for everyone on the ground, and the response to that was massive. So we had this scheduled election in 2022, and we knew in the build-up to the election that there was going to be an effort by mainstream media and by unionism and by particular elements within unionism to turn this into a very bitter, very negative campaign. Keep Sinn Féin out, vote down the line in order to keep Sinn Féin out. And we as a party did not engage in that. And we went to the people with a positive message about delivery, about trying to make progress on rights, about putting money in workers' and families' pockets. And we could see the reception that we were getting for that. And people could see through the spin and the bluster that was coming from the DUP, who were focused on a protocol and making a full argument there and refusing to state whether or not they would enter government if Sinn Féin were in the position to take First Minister. And when that came to pass, we've seen the reaction from political unionism, and it has been negative, but people understand what we're trying to do here and are with us. So obviously we're now the largest party in the 6 county state. That was something that was never supposed to happen. Mary McDonnell pointed it out in the wake of the election. Michelle O'Neill is now our First Minister designate in a state that was designed to never have a Michelle O'Neill in any position of power. And that ground has been broken, and things have changed and changed irrevocably, and people know that. And it's just one of those, it's an exciting time to be a Republican. It's an exciting time to be a United Irelander and to be living through this and to be part of it. It's fantastic. And sometimes you're doing the general day-to-day tasks of what you're involved in as an elected rep, and you can lose sight of the bigger picture. But obviously that's where we're at now. So we can see Michelle, and we stated all along, we want to be First Minister for all. And Michelle has demonstrated that even whilst she's not allowed to be First Minister in the things, whether it be laying a wreath a few weeks ago in remembrance of the Somme, attending the Eid festival in West Belfast the other day, compared to, and in stark contrast to what we've seen over recent days, where political unionism has once again endorsed and stayed silent in the wake of loyalists and bonfire burners exploiting the same thing over and over again in terms of misogynistic, sectarian, hate-filled demonstrations through their bonfires and burning of effigies and burning of my national flag and all of those things. And you can get pulled into that sort of debate, and you can get pulled into that sort of negativity. But we as a party have chosen not to do that. And I suppose that's where we're at. And just meeting those challenges and talking about real change and laying out how we would deliver for people. And because we are a grassroots organisation who are all still activists in our local areas and working on the ground, whether that be taking part in litter picks or attending GAA matches or out and about talking to people, we're getting that feedback on the ground. So I suppose for myself, it's an exciting time. And I think it's an exciting time for anyone involved in left politics. You can see the bigger picture across the water with yourselves, what's happening there. And people will see through that. And it's then for us as socialists to present a more positive way forward and allow people to choose that opportunity when it arises. So I hope that's been somewhat helpful. Thanks very much, Rachel.
It has been very helpful indeed, and thank you so much. And solidarity, it's just it gave me goosebumps again when you said reminded us that Michelle O'Neill should be the First Minister, although it's pretty appalling that she hasn't been able to take that position, and so brilliant to hear about the policies that you were able to take forward, left policies that we don't really hear about as much as we should. So thanks ever so much, Emma, and thanks to everyone who's watching, and it's great to see people tuning in from all across the country. And do remember to put your questions in the Q&A. I'm just going to go over to one of the Arise Festival volunteers, Ben, to talk about a little bit about the festival before we move on to our next speaker.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I'm here in the what's been called the Bob Geldof role, I believe, before. Obviously, it does cost money to use Zoom webinar and sort of streaming services for events like this. And there should be a link to donate being posted in the chat. I believe the suggested donation is £10, but any support all is very much welcome. I know times are hard for a lot of people at the moment, but if you can help, it is very much appreciated. Tonight's session is part of a month-long programme of kind of meetings on various different topics. If you've missed any of the ones up to this point, they're all available to watch on our social media platforms. The next evening event will be coming up on Monday at 7 p.m. Standing Up for Palestine, and we'll have a range of labour movement and international speakers. Hopefully some of you will join us there, and thanks very much.
Brilliant. Thanks, Ben. And thanks for all the work that you and all the other volunteers do. The programme this year is outstanding, as usual. Our next speaker is Geoff Bell, who is from Labour for Irish Unity, and who's the author of The Twilight of Unionism, which is going to be coming out in the autumn. We look forward to that, and I'm going to hand over to Geoff now. Just unmute yourself, Geoff, if you can.
Lovely. Right, there we go. Can I just, first of all, start by congratulating Emma and indeed the rest of the Sinn Féin on their marvellous election success, really. I think the sort of British left in the past have had a sort of record of trying to tell Irish people and Irish republicanism how to behave and what to do and how to win success. And I think that's where the tables have been turned in the last couple of years. So I think we should sort of listen to them. And for me, the sort of most important thing about Sinn Féin is not only our politics, but the fact that people like Emma come from and represent and are part of their community. And I think that's something we should actually recognise. So anyway, in the recent election, the other notable result was the decline in the unionist vote. And that's essentially what I want to talk about this evening. The decline meant that the leading unionist party, the DUP, ran a poor second to Sinn Féin. And this is something we can also celebrate as well as celebrating Sinn Féin's victory. Before the Troubles, the leading unionist party received between 65 and 75% of the vote at parliamentary elections in the north of Ireland. Now the total unionist vote at the last election was reduced to 40%. And we celebrate this because unionism in Northern Ireland, before that unionism in all of Ireland, was the cause of privilege, the party of privilege, the party of sectarianism, of discrimination, and of the divide and rule of the working class. And all of this, of course, the British state were the initiators or the supporters. The great example of this was the partition of Ireland in 1921, when despite Sinn Féin winning 70% of the vote, the British created a six-county state in the northeast of Ireland, specifically designed to opt out of Irish majority rule, specifically aimed at sort of stopping Irish majority rule. And today we are seeing something similar, although on a much smaller scale, of course, with the DUP refusing to accept the verdict of the voters in Northern Ireland and sit in a power-sharing government in which Sinn Féin would be the first minister. Now, while the DUP tend to say this is because of the protocol, of course, the DUP have throughout their history said no to sort of many things. Indeed, earlier this year, they said they wouldn't refuse to sit in the power-sharing government if the Irish language legislation was passed, which it now seems to be likely it's sort of going to sort of happen. And of course, the DUP came to power on their opposition to the Good Friday Agreement. They were always and have always been against that. And they have also been against such things as the which were part of the Good Friday's provisions on such things like the rights of the Irish language, attendance at, they have limited their attendance at All Ireland institutions established by the GFA. They've refused to support human rights legislation, and of course they've refused to support legal inquiry into the crimes committed by British soldiers and other security forces in the north of Ireland. And then they and their supporters have resisted, often with physical violence, riots and so on, such things as limiting the flying of the Union Jack, the reform of the police, and the so-called right of the Orange Order to march in Catholic areas. All of these issues have in some way challenged the Unionist sense of entitlement to a six-county state in which they should be allowed to do as they please. And the Good Friday Agreement did challenge that. And as Emma said, the traditional attitudes still go on. She mentioned bonfires. I mean, one of them had the slogan KAT at the top of this, and KAT means kill all Tags, and Tags is by Tags I meant Catholics, and a sort of another bonfire had a sort of image of the sort of Pope of Rome at the top. So you can sort of see that the sectarianism, the horrible, nasty sectarianism, is still sadly alive of this. And now we have the fact that the Tories have been sort of pandering to this, most notably by saying that the protocol, the Irish protocol in the European agreement has to go, despite this having majority support in Northern Ireland. But there has been, and I think this is the other thing which is very important to sort of mention, there has been a significant break from all of this by a small but significant section of the Protestant population. This is represented by the growth of the Alliance Party, who are neutral on the border issue, but who have supported the agenda of cultural and social equality, including on a woman's right to choose and marriage equality. Now, I, as someone brought up in what could be described as a Belfast Liberal Protestant home, personally, of course, welcome the growth of the Alliance Party within the Protestant community. And this has always been there has always been this radical phase, radical wing within that group. The tradition was, of course, established in the 1790s when Protestants formed the Republican movement, and it was them who played a leading role at that stage. So it's been this radicalism has always been a tradition, a minority one. I mean, it has to be faced this, and it's still a quite small one. But it is glad that it's really good that it has re-emerged and sort of hopefully the Alliance's partner with Sinn Féin over such issues as abortion, marriage equality, as well as their past opposition to Brexit and of course support for the protocol. Hopefully this partnership is a sign of things to come. So unionism is in decline and is in crisis. And the question I sort of want to end with, the question is why at this time of unionism's greatest unpopularity in Northern Ireland, and of course in Ireland as a whole, why is it that the leadership of our Labour Party is more supportive of the union than it has been at any time since the 1970s. Keir Starmer has made his support for the union clear in speeches and in visits to the north and the south of Ireland when he has declared his unequivocal support for the union, saying it's a force for good, which is a remarkable thing to actually argue for. He has also said on one occasion that in the event of a referendum, he would actually go to Ireland and campaign against Irish unity. Imagine as a sort of member of our party, the leadership of our party, going and campaigning in the country concerned against self-determination. That is what has been promised. So I just say this, and I end with this. Here you are supporting a cause that is not only dying, but whose history makes it deserve to actually die. It is a reactionary creed. It is a politics of divide and rule, and it's a sort of politics of sort of sectarianism and even hate. So to be supporting that, especially at this time when it's sort of dying, is actually a remarkable thing to do. And as I say in Belfast, here, catch yourself on. Thank you. That's all.
Thanks, Geoff. And I think Keir could do with watching quite a few of these webinars and learning a thing or two. So John McDonnell is sort of with us, but he is in the middle of voting on the protocol bill. So he will be joining us later, but I'm just going to go to Emma for a question, if that's okay, while we're waiting for John to come back. So this has come in through Facebook. Sinn Féin's amazing successes, both in the north and south of Ireland, have been led by the youth vote. How can progressives in Britain build a similar coalition? And to say a little bit about that youth vote.
Thank you. Yeah, absolutely right. And probably something that I should have maybe focused on more in my opening remarks. I think probably key for us in attracting a younger vote, well, apart from the fact that our policies are progressive and lefty, and that generally will be what younger people are attracted to, is that we have, as a party, deliberately attempted to be more representative and have deliberately sought out younger people, and particularly young women, to stand for us. And I sort of touched on this at the very beginning, in that I'm not a career politician. I joined Sinn Féin when I was about 18 because in my own local area, I could see certain things happening. I could see Sinn Féin members and the work that they were doing. I had an interest in Irish history. I felt an umbrage at the fact that our country had been partitioned, and I could see a correlation between earlier phases of our struggle and what was happening with my own local Sinn Féin membership at that time, and how they were trying to redress the wrongs of the past. And so that activism, when you're in your area and you're taking part in community events and you're getting involved in whatever sort of initiatives are going on around you, you naturally then are clicked in, and eventually somebody will sort of catch you and ask you if you want to stand. And 9 out of 10 of our MLAs will tell you a long story about how it took years or months to wear them down, to get them to be convinced to do what they're currently doing as their full-time job. But that will attract then younger people, and they'll be able to see, you know, people will contact me and I had no idea what politicians do, and it's just completely irrelevant to me. One of the big things, and sort of something that any left campaign in Britain should be doing, and obviously very successful examples of it already, is the sort of social media and showing, I suppose, our own recent campaign. We could see where our social media team and our sort of media team in general used social media particularly to demonstrate the realness of our elected reps, particularly Michelle, and her popularity amongst the young vote was a massive part of her success.
Thanks, Emma, that's really encouraging. Hopefully we've got John now, if he's not going to have to dash off again. So to quickly introduce our next speaker, stalwart of the left, linchpin of Jeremy Corbyn's leadership team and long-standing friend of Ireland. And I don't know how long we've got him for before he has to rush off again. So our next speaker, John McDonnell, MP.
Thanks, Rachel. The irony of it is that we're voting on the Irish protocol legislation. So it's fairly tedious in the extreme. I'll just give an example of the intransigence of this government. There's a sort of a coalition of Labour, Lib Dems and others within the chamber. And one of the amendments is simply asking the government to publish the legal advice that they received on the protocol, and the government's resistant. It is just, it's a reflection, isn't it, of the classical way which Boris Johnson has governed and the way in which he stitched up the whole pre-Brexit negotiations around this as well, on a wing and a prayer, which were never going to work either, quite honestly. Look, I'll be very brief. I listened to a bit of Emma before I could go away, and also to Geoff Bell. It's really good to see Geoff again after all the work that he's done over here. And one of the points that Geoff made is the English socialists or the English Labour and trade union movement needs to be careful about how it intervenes with regard to Ireland itself, because at different stages there has been, I think Geoff made this point, where some on the left in this country have almost arrogantly tried to dictate the terms of the political debate. I can remember Gerry Adams once saying, as an aside really, that there was some on the left in the UK, in England in particular, that were more revolutionary than the IRA Army Council at one point in time. It was quite remarkable. But the reality is this, that with the Irish diaspora here in particular, obviously takes an interest about the long-term future, but also, and that's the point that Geoff's work has been about really, is to recognise the history as well. And what's so, I've never been more optimistic, to be honest. What's so interesting is what a key point in Irish history this is. This is since 1921, Northern Ireland, as it was called, has been dominated by unionism, absolutely dominated. And this is the first time when that no longer is the case. And there's an opportunity, I think a huge opportunity, for a new type of politics, a new political dispensation. And I heard a little bit of Geoff before I went. What I found really impressive is the way in which Sinn Féin has addressed that. And I think exciting, creatively, but actually an incredibly sophisticated way too, about discussing what the future will be. The fact that unionism no longer dominates is just down to simple factors, really. Demographic change overall. It was inevitable. It was coming and predicted that the nationalist community eventually would have a larger population mass than those that were unionist. That was inevitably predicted. And so a lot of the discussions for over the years is what then happens and how do people come to terms with that. But I think it's quite different as well now. It's not just that demographic change. It's the fact there's a new generation come through on all sides. And that new generation, those young people really, whether nationalist or unionist, many of them are much more open-minded than ever before. So I think they're more open to people working together and the prospect, therefore, of a united country. I think the border poll, I didn't hear what Emma said about this, but I think there's an increasing recognition that a border poll is inevitable. It will come, it's just a matter of when. And therefore, it's the discussions of what happens in advance of that poll and the preparations and the discussion that needs to take place. And it is about creating a new Ireland. And what does that mean? And I actually do think a lot of this rests upon the economic debate and what economic prospects we can hold out to people about a commitment to full employment, a commitment to people having a decent standard of living, high wages, linked to the development of investment across the whole of the country. in a way on a scale that the North certainly hasn't seen for decades, and lifting people out of the elements of poverty that still exist there as a result of the lack of investment and the lack of vision, economic vision that there's been in the past. And what I found really interesting is about this debate about shaping the new society and how that will be brought about. So all the discussions and policies that Sinn Féin, for example, have been advancing around climate change, how you invest to tackle climate change, how you create a Green New Deal for the whole of Ireland, and how you can therefore create the jobs. It reflects much of what we've said here, but actually now could become a reality, could become reality on the ground, and actually could be working on the leading edge of some of those economic environmental policies that are needed. The other issue as well, I'm fascinated by the discussion about what's been going on with regard to public services. Over the years, the public services in the North have been underfunded, but at the same time, they're subject to the same privatisation and outsourcing that's taken place as a result of UK governments experimenting with the neoliberalism. Well, that experiment has failed and that's recognised now. So I think there's a thorough understanding about the need now for, across the whole of Ireland, a form of health service that is under public and democratic control, properly funded via the fair taxation system. I'm interested also in the debate that's gone on about how do you look at the constitutional rules that will follow from the debate about a united Ireland, and how I suppose you can reassure people about that their rights and their culture will be protected. And again, what's been really interesting is the way that Sinn Féin has opened its arms to that debate and invited people in to express their concerns, but also to put forward their solutions as well. A lot of it is about enshrining the Good Friday Agreement, obviously, in terms of future bills of rights, etc. But often it goes beyond that. And I think Geoff mentioned the issues of the wrangles that there's been in the past about culture and language and about how they can be resolved. But again, what I find interesting is that there's a debate about long-term planning now, both economic and social and cultural, in a way that we haven't had before. So that the electoral victories that have taken place for Sinn Féin, I think, have opened up those opportunities that weren't there before. Plus, you know, I agree, Emma made reference to this, you can't help but commend the leadership of Sinn Féin at the moment in the way that they've attractively and creatively communicated their ideas, but also their willingness to listen and engage. And the only intransigence that there's been, to be frank, has been from largely a UK government that's failed to listen and has encouraged the worst elements of unionism to go back into their, unfortunately, back into their shells. I'm really optimistic. The issue for us is what can we do here? I think what we can do is listen, support, provide whatever ideas that we can that we think would be useful. But I think most importantly for the Labour left in particular over here, is to learn some lessons about how you promote policy, you bring people together, and how you communicate. One of the areas I'm particularly interested in, obviously, when I shadow chancellor, was around how you get long-term investment with a fair taxation system, and how you harness, therefore, the economic structures that we have. Because we have this issue of the Irish Protocol, which again is a disastrous mistake by the Tories, what we've got to do is make sure we don't cut ourselves off from that engagement and that discussion. Because the reality is, of course, we want a border poll. Of course, we want the border removed. But actually, we did have a Europe with no borders as well. And it's how do we get back to that debate and discussion about what sort of Europe do we want in the future, of which Ireland and hopefully the UK will be part of, maybe not in the old structures of the EU, but certainly in some different forms of structures and new roles and abilities to engage that not only secures peace for the future, but also economic prosperity for everybody and, above all else, survival in the face of the threat of climate change. So, I'm optimistic. There's lots of lessons that we can learn. And I just, one lesson, maybe for the Labour leadership, if we could communicate as effectively as the leadership of Sinn Féin, we might stand a prospect of winning the next general election. But as I say, I live in hope. We've discovered Mick Lynch over here. There might be others as well that we can discover. Thanks, Rachel.
Thanks, John. Your optimism is as welcome as ever, and it is an optimistic situation we're talking about for a change, although not. I think it'll take more than improved communication for the Labour leadership to improve what it's doing. So I've got quite a lot of questions, and then I'm going to ask each of the panellists to come back. I hope John can stay with us for a little bit longer. I'll take Geoff, John, then Emma on the way back, so John does get a bit of a breather. So the questions are from Kevin on YouTube. I think this is particularly for Emma. What is going to happen in regards to stopping the violence and sectarian actions of the loyalists in the occupied counties? And I'll just add myself, it has been quite shocking to see what's been going on the last few days. A question from Pat Sott. Hi, Pat, I think he's in my constituency. Would it be possible for counties like Fermanagh and others to detach themselves from what is referred to as Northern Ireland, making the state totally unviable? And then I think this one is for Geoff and John in particular. John's referred to it. The Labour front bench is seemingly not budging from a disappointing position on the north of Ireland in terms of a border poll. How can we campaign to bring about a change to that policy? I would add, you know, is there anything that we can take to Labour Party conference this year, being, you know, so topical as it is? I'll give you a minute or two to think about that while I just thank everyone who's tuned in tonight. We've got over 300 people watching from London, Norfolk, California, Rome, Liverpool, and many other places. It's a brilliant ongoing festival, and it runs right up until Arise runs up right up until July the 27th. There is information in the chat, but in case you're not seeing that and you're watching on social media, the next Arise event is this Friday the 15th at 1 p.m. Which is part of the Lefty Lunchtime series about can the left win, which is a good question. I think we would all welcome some answers to. I think Sinn Féin's example shows us that we can and must. The next, on Monday, we've got a big rally on Now is the Time to Speak Up for Palestine at 7 o'clock. So do tune in for those. We've got important battles to win, and hopefully our speakers will now have had a little bit of time to think about the quite diverse questions and any final conclusions about, you know, the lessons. That's what we want, lessons for the left over here. What do we need to do? Geoff, you first. I'll mute you again. Can you unmute?
Okay. Right, sorry, I got a wee message there. I'll concentrate on this question of the violence of the loyalists. Now, traditionally, the sort of the violence of the sort of loyalism has come when they've been assured of British support for this. I mean, the classic example was 1912 to 1914, when they threatened civil war. If Ireland was given home rule and were supported and armed by the Tories at the time. And people don't become violent or nasty or sort of horrible for no reason. They do it because they think, and in the loyalist case, they think it will be successful. And the whole sort of election campaign which we've just had in the north of Ireland was a twofold thing. There was the election campaign itself, and there was a series of anti-protocol rallies in which the language was threats of violence, was sort of violence itself, and so on and so on. And that was what happened. And of course, after that, after the sort of election, the Tories gave in to what those people were demanding, i.e. a promise to end the protocol. So again, if you give in to that type of violence and that type of rhetoric by the British government, the British government gives in, then you will continue doing it, you know? And it's not because, you know, the sort of daily mirror when Theresa May was having her flirtation with the DUP, said, you know, the Daily Mirror had this famous headline, crackpots, and it went on how the DUP were sort of crackpots and loyalists are crackpots. Well, they're not actually crackpots. They're doing things for reasons to try and maintain the privileges they've got. And secondly, because they think if they behave badly enough, the Brits will give in, right, to them and give in to the whole privilege which they created in sort of first place. So the best way to stop that violence is for it to, and the sort of horrible things which sort of happened, even in the last couple of days, and happened certainly during the election campaign, you know, with the hoax bombs and offices being wrecked and all this sort of stuff. The best way is to people say, well, this aren't going to change for every move you make in sort of this way, the sort of British should be not only condemning, but sort of reinforcing that the aim of this, what the loyalists want from these sort of things won't simply pass. And that means condemnation left, right, and centre, and indeed, again, by the sort of Labour Party. Now, what can we do? What can we do about this? Well, as I say, I'm also speaking here for Labour for Irish Unity, and we're having a big rally at the Labour Party conference on the theme of start the conversation, i.e. start the conversation of what we in Britain can do, and especially in the progressive movement, to help speed up the realization of a sort of 32 county Ireland. And I think that's the thing. And as I say, and I think John's absolutely right, and I've said before, we won't be telling to the Irish, you have to do this, that, and the other thing. I mean, even a right-wing government in Ireland has produced higher pensions, higher unemployment benefits than they have in the UK. It's produced more doctors per population, more nurses per population, and so on like this. It is not some sort of backward little state anymore. And as I say, that's under what has been a right-wing government in sort of Ireland. Once Sinn Fein gets to power, as I think they will, and certainly if you one should study what they're saying on sort of things like sort of housing, you know, for example, then once that sort of happens, we in the left will be sort of running to sort of keep up with them. But I mean, as I say, there's this conversation going on. How do we contribute without telling the Irish people what to do? How can the left can contribute to achieving a border poll and achieving something which would appeal to the Irish people as a whole? And the first thing, as I say, is to say, and this comes back, if you like, in a sort of circle, the first thing we have to make clear is to tell the loyalists and the Taylor Strip unionists, actually, mate, we don't want you, right? We think your place is with your fellow Irish people over there. And I think if that message comes out clear, that will be another little straw on sort of what will break the sort of unions back.
Thanks, Geoff, and very much looking forward to your book coming out in the autumn. And we've shared a platform intermittently over the last few years, and I feel like every time we do, we're a step closer to a united Ireland. So we'll look forward to that rally at a Labour Party conference, certainly. John, would you like to comment on some of those questions?
I can unmute, I will. Yep, done it. Okay, I'm on an iPad rather than my computer here because I'm moving about a bit. Sorry about that. Just on the issue of the violence, just to take on from Geoff, what we've tried to do is undermine any form of rationale that will enable some people to promote violence. And with regard to the protocol, that's, I think that's readily done with the correct political approach from the UK, actually, because it was Boris Johnson who stitched the thing up and then basically lied about it. And the solution is fairly straightforward. The EU is perfectly willing to negotiate to overcome any of the issues, and it has done already, has offered concession after concession to enable the system to operate effectively. And if the UK government were willing to get back around the table, it's completely resolvable. That undermines the excuse unionists or others have to then going into either political sulk, but also even allowing them to enable the argument then to develop into violence itself. So it's, I think it's that process by which you eradicate any of the combustible materials that any spark can then set alight. And that's the strategy that actually Sinn Féin has been pursuing consistently now. And it's the one that should be reinforced. On Geoff's point, it should be reinforced by any UK government. So you're not giving any backing to those that will want to walk away from the table at any time, and encourage others to do as well. Just on the issue of the approach overall, I want to make absolutely clear, as the ideas are developed in Ireland itself, one of the things that we can do from here is say, what joint lessons are there can we work together on to learn how we can transform our societies? And there are a whole range of issues there about how you go about a fair taxation system, how do you redistribute wealth, etc., where we can learn from each other effectively how best it's done. And in a number of areas, exactly as Geoff has said, even under a right-wing administration in Ireland, they've developed on. And if you look at, for example, what happened in support during COVID, we were miles behind what the support that was being given in Ireland. And we had to really, we forced through the schemes of support here, the furlough scheme and all the rest of it here. But Ireland were in advance. So there's lots of joint working that I think we can do where we learn lessons from each other, both domestically, but also internationally as well. One of the things that I think we can work on jointly is about international interventions, particularly with regard to how we support the movements within the global south, tackling some of the issues of maldistribution of resources and exploitation of the global south as well. Getting back to the Labour Party, though, the Labour Party is not a unionist party. No matter what some elements of the Labour leadership have said, it's never been a conservative and unionist party like that. It's never been a Labour and unionist party. It's been the Labour Party. And within the Labour Party, it's always had a strain of development, if you like, of ideas about the importance of people having the right of self-determination. And that's what I believe that the Labour Party rests upon as the base, one of the basic principles of its role, both, as I say, within our own country, but also internationally as well. We should build upon that. And the way that we can build upon it at the moment is making sure there's an actual debate. Because at the moment, every time a Labour Party spokesperson goes on the television, they're asked the question, what would you do? The response is, well, wait until we publish the manifesto. It'll be too late by then. So one of the things we can do as rank of our Labour Party members and rank of our trade unionists with those affiliated to the Labour Party is encourage the debate and engage in that debate constructively. So that's why Labour for Irish Unity now is so important and the role it can play. I'm glad the conference meeting is taking place, but I think maybe a number of us need to give more energy and support to Labour for Irish Unity. The Labour Party Irish Society we set up after we had the Labour Party Irish section. It took a long campaign. I was one of the founding members of it. Unfortunately, now it's become more of a social club than a political animal. So the Labour for Irish Unity, I think, becomes the vehicle where we can have that debate about how we can, first of all, fully understand what's happening in Ireland, but then also how we can contribute supportively and how we can learn joint lessons. But reiterating to those in the Labour Party, we're the Labour Party. We are not the Labour and Unionist Party and never have been.
Absolutely. Thanks ever so much, John. And thanks for dashing about and being able to join us. And some, as always, some real sort of concrete things we can all do in our local Labour parties and, you know, in the Labour Party structures, you know, so learning about how you transform society, learning the lessons from around the globe, as well as, you know, between Britain and Ireland, and, you know, listening and supporting a thing and raising the level of political education is something we can all contribute to. It's been brilliant to hear from you, Emma, and to that you were able to join us and keep us up to date this evening. And I'm going to let you finish off with some answers to those questions. And thanks again for spending the time and talking to us.
Not at all. Thank you for having me. And I've enjoyed the conversation as well. I suppose just on the two things, the point around the violence, I would echo what Geoff had said initially in his remarks. And it's the first thing that I always say when the question is put to me, usually by people in the 26 counties about, you know, what would happen if there was a border poll and the loyalists took up arms. And the first thing to say is that loyalists were never able to fight a war in Ireland without the support of the British government. And that was key and integral and oftentimes the motivation behind what they were doing. But beyond that, the headlines are not nice. And even what we're seeing in recent days, it's not pleasant. But we have to remember that that is a tiny, tiny minority. And the people who are involved in that, the vast majority of whom, are there because they are living in an area where politics of fear dominates. And they have been manipulated by criminals in their areas who are using them for their own means. And that's the reality of it. And it's a minority. In order to stamp it out, we have to call it out, and we have to show that there is another way. And I suppose that leads very nicely into the question around how we could further partition Ireland by maybe removing areas where there is, you know, a nationalist representation or a nationalist majority. And I would reject that and would not want to see anything like that happening. Our whole objective is to build a new Ireland which is inclusive, and nationalists and republicans do not want to see a repeat of history. We do not want to see what was done on my ancestors that were put onto the mountains where they were expected to not be able to make a living. We don't want to see that done to anybody else, and that's not what we're about. So, you know, carve up by demographics or carve up by numbers or carve up by religion or political persuasion is not Sinn Féin politics and is not what we would like to see. And that's what we're doing through our positive campaign and through the politics that we've been demonstrating in recent times. We're putting our hands out across the divide. We're trying to engage with others. We're showing people we don't have horns. We don't pose any risk. In a united Ireland, there'll still be a 12th. There won't maybe be bonfires. You'll not be able to burn our flag. But there still is going to be cultural expression, and anyone who's British will be welcome to live their life as a British citizen. And that's what I would like to see going forward, and the two traditions living happily side by side and everyone being respected and history being acknowledged. So that I hope helps. And thanks very much for having me. I really enjoyed this and nice to talk to you and all.
Brilliant. Thanks, Emma. Thanks, Geoff. Thanks, John. And thanks, everyone, for joining us. And see you on Friday for the next Arise event.